I believe that if you want something to happen, you got to be there along with the workers. They got to feel that you are part of the whole system and they are part of it. So whilst I was there the whole day, it was a very hot day, and I think so much of garbage at the site made the area even hotter. So I was so very thirsty, had a cold glass of water, and I have a bad cold. So if I have to cough in between or something like that, please excuse me. The main thing, why we have a garbage problem in Goa, it's not that we have it only in Goa, we have it of course all over India. We've been to a lot of places out of India, I mean in India, to see how they are managing their garbage. We heard about so-called best practices. And we thought that let's take, when I say we, I went on behalf of the monitoring committee, and Mr. Sanjeev Rodriguez also is a part of it. And we decided let's go and see what they're doing in Bombay, what they're doing in Vasai, and maybe we can follow their example. Of course, we came back very disappointed, and though, as we were told, we're going to see one of the best plants in India, and they've set up in 24 cities in India. We thought we would come back wiser and we would do something better, but that really did not happen. We were really very disappointed because all the waste that they got there was mixed waste. And I strongly believe that when garbage is mixed, there's no way you can treat garbage. This garbage can only be dumped. And I do not believe in dumping of waste. What we have to do is treat waste, not dump it. Now, why exactly did we have this garbage problem in Goa? Earlier, if you remember the 70s or even the early 80s, we had no problem. Our streets were clean, our surroundings were clean. We had a nice little bungalow, maybe six people living in that bungalow. But of course, as years pass, things change. More people come to live, and I mean the family expands, and then you got to build more. And that's where our planners come in. Unfortunately today, our planners really think of development as building construction development. They never look at holistic development, and I may be very harsh in saying this, but I think our planners have failed us miserably. That is why today we are in such a bad position. And if you look at this one house, the zoning changed, the FAR changed, and where we used to get garbage from a family of six, which if you take each person would generate about half a kilo of waste, and you would have 3 kilos per day, you have about 50, 60 families living in this. So you can imagine how much garbage was generated and is being generated from a building like this, and there's no way where the garbage can go. Because earlier, those people would feed it to their dogs, to their cats, maybe to the birds, and maybe compost it in their backyard. But when you have a building like this, you have hardly any space for composting. So the thing is, the garbage has to go somewhere. And when nobody is ready to have a composting unit close by, because everybody says not near my window and not near his window and not near their window, and in the end the garbage is just dumped and has to go somewhere else. So basically, I'm very sure that our planners have failed us. And added to this, we have another problem. Our lifestyles have changed. Earlier, we would cook at home, make time to cook, manage to feed our children. If they were going to school or to work, send food with them in the tiffin or whatever it is. But we would generate very little waste. Today, we have all ready-to-eat foods, so why not? Why spend our time cooking at home when we can get ready-to-eat foods? But what happens to this when you just start eating all this, forget the nutrition value of it, but what happens to the waste? It's nobody's concern really. Eat the stuff, throw the waste, and what is left over is nobody's concern. It's for the local body to manage. Then we have snacks that used to be made at home. But again, nobody has time to make snacks. Why make snacks when you get ready to eat packets in the supermarket? Why not buy that? But what happens to that in the end is really nobody's concern. And then we used to buy spices in the market, grind our own garlic, ginger, pepper, whatever we had, make our masalas at home. But we changed all that. Now it's easier to buy ready-made spices, but what happens to the waste is again nobody's concern. What about shoes? You know, when we bought a pair of shoes, I remember that I had one pair of shoes which has to last me for about 2 years, 3 years. Go to the local mochi, repair it, polish it, and use it. And it will last us for a long time. But today what you have shoes available, slippers available from China, from everywhere they have come, buy and throw. We've got into that throwaway culture. And every day, believe it or not, we get, this is at our sorting center, which is in Santanes, and we get this entire crate full of shoes, every day. Remember, these are all non-recyclables. Nobody wants these shoes. Nobody wants to take shoes from here. If you look at it, those slippers don't look too bad. But even our workers have enough of shoes that they've had. Initially, they would take a pair home. Today, nobody wants it. And then you have so many shoes, and you just don't know what to do with it. You know, I think even our attitude and the way we look at garbage, even that has changed. We all live in our own comfort zone. We're not bothered what happens around us. We don't care what happens to our neighbors. Even if you put up boards like this, no garbage zone. This is in Polvari, opposite the Xavier Center. You'll find garbage strewn all around. We don't notice it. We go past it because we drive in these beautiful fancy cars that we have. Tinted glasses, we pull them up, AC, you don't get the smell. But we don't mind adding to it as we go along. We just add to the waste and go. Who cares really? This is a picture of the bus stand. Garbage dumped in the corner. Again, what do? We add to it. We don't really do anything. And even if we find someone doing this, we'll pass by and not say, excuse me, you're not doing the right thing. Please don't do this. Use the toilet. There are toilets at the bus stand. But we'll never say that. But I think we should start getting involved and try to tell these people. I'm sure that they would feel bad about it. I do it in Kampal. In fact, I live in Kampal. You all know it's a lovely, romantic, cozy place with a lot of trees around. And also when people get down from the bus, the first thing they will do is pass by. Somehow, I don't know how they feel like urinating when they reach there. And then they will go to office. But I go there with my camera. Believe me, I don't click, but I just go there with my camera, stand behind the person and I say, excuse me, so that he turns and show him that I've got his face. And then he says, very sorry, I will not do it again. But there's some way that we've got to stop all this. But this is only adding to our garbage. As it is, garbage stinks and we make it stink even more. We've become so immune to garbage, completely immune to it, that this is the river Sal. And if you look at this place, you have garbage all around and even the water has gone so black and it's oily. I don't know what is thrown inside, but then you have people fishing in this water and probably selling the fish to passers-by. And God knows who bought this fish and what can happen later. but we are really immune to all this rubbish. You know, we all know that we have rules in place. We say we have rules and, you know, abide by rules. And all of you all must be knowing that we have the plastic recycle rules, where the thickness of a bag that you can use is 40 microns, not less than 40 microns. Unfortunately, when we go to the market, there are still people dispensing bags which are less than 40 microns. Enforcement is one part of it. But we find people refusing to take goods from that shopkeeper if he doesn't give them a bag. And they say, if you don't give me a bag, I will go to the next shop and I will buy my goods. And that is what the shopkeeper tells us. Madam, if you don't give a bag, they go past us and they buy goods at the next shop. I think we should change our attitude, because when we go to the market, instead of telling the person that we will not buy your goods if you don't give us a bag, why not use it the other way? Say, we will not take your goods if you give us a bag. I'm not going to buy your goods. So let's change that, so that the shopkeeper doesn't dispense these bags so freely. Can we change all this? I'm sure we can. Because we can't go on like this, but it's only with community participation, with people's participation, with us understanding everything, that we can change this. And we at the CCP, we have learned from our mistakes. I don't say that Panjim is great and garbage, you know, everything is going very well. There are a lot of problems. There were a lot of problems. We are trying to improve. We are improving every day. We still have a long way to go. But we have learned from our past mistakes. I don't know if you recognize this place, but this is Purka. This used to be a very deep quarry. A quarry that would last Panjim another, from the time it was built, another 10 years or so. Because I had a look at this quarry and I said, okay, another 10 years, we are okay. But another 10 years if we do not continue dumping waste in that quarry. But that did not happen. As I said, waste was dumped, dumped, and dumped. That quarry became a mountain. Leachate started flowing out of this mountain. During the monsoons, the wall broke. It went through the wall, went down into the fields, and destroyed the crops of people living around. At that time, we in Panjim did not bother because we didn't care. Our garbage had gone away. We didn't have the waste in Panjim. It was going to some other place. But we didn't realize that we were destroying somebody else's life. And this is what happened. And until the people there got up and made a noise, this did not stop. And once it stopped, we had a huge problem. Where was Panjim to go with its waste? And that is when our problems really started. We had this, you must all remember this round cement bin that were put all around the city. We had the cement bins. Everybody would dump garbage into those bins. Burn it sometimes. It used to overflow. You would see dogs and cows and everybody turning the bin, throwing it down. And that was a big problem. So something had to be done. So at that time, you had the swarm project. Many of you all might remember the swarm project of the government of India, which was to be implemented in Goa. At that time, they thought of replacing the cement bins with the metal bins. And then you had these hydraulic trucks that would pick up the metal bins and empty waste into the truck instead of taking off the cement bin and manually doing it. So all around the city, you had these two metallic bins placed, one black, one green, for people to segregate their waste. Whoever did it, it was dumping, not from close, even from far. Where the green had the same type of waste that the black had. So we realized that this also was a big problem. In 2003, we said something has to be done. And when I say we, I'm talking about the CCP. So when something had to be done, and the bin that was supposed to solve a problem, people use it wisely, the bin itself became a problem. So we had to get rid of the bins and came up with the Bin Free 2003 campaign. Now when we came up with this campaign, we said we're going to remove all the bins from the city. But what's going to happen? We have to collect waste from everybody's doorstep so that they don't come, the garbage doesn't come onto the road. And we decided to have a 3-month long campaign, not start the bin free immediately. We had to plan, because planning is very important. So we planned and we got, you know, the headmasters, headmistresses of all the schools in Panjim for a meeting. And at this meeting, we asked all of them, can you give us about 10 or 15 students from each of your schools? So 9 schools and colleges came together. They gave us students. And then we had training sessions for these students for a period of 3 months. We trained the students. We prepared leaflets that were to be distributed in the zones. We divided the city into 15 zones. And once this training was completed, that means what do you put into the green bin, what do you put into the black bin, then only did we start this campaign. We had separate collection. We had separate trucks to pick up your wet waste and a separate truck to pick up your dry waste. So we started with the door-to-door collection, because if you do not have door-to-door collection, then this waste comes onto the road. Now, removing bins is okay, but what do people do with their small litter? So we decided to put these litter bins onto the streets. And these litter bins works to be used for litter. Litter, you might have chewing gum, you might have a small bit of paper. But unfortunately, maybe people didn't realize what this is, considered it a dustbin. And then we found fish and meat and chicken and everything into these bins. Not only inside the bin, on top of it and below it. So again, this litter bin became a problem. But we still feel today that we need litter bins in the city, and the municipality has ordered for bins and we are going to put them around. But it's only that people, you know, we have to create that much awareness where people know that a litter bin is to be used as a litter bin and not as anything else. Now, as I said earlier, segregation at source is very important. When we told people that you've got to segregate your waste, keep it out, keep it at your door, and on certain days, the worker will come to collect it. For instance, the green bin would be collected every day because it's wet waste, you can't keep it home for too long, and the black bin would be collected on every Mondays and Thursdays. But then we had, you know, how problems come about. Oh, you know, that's not going to be possible because I go out to work. And if I keep the bin outside, we're going to have dogs that will chew the waste around. So at that time we said, okay, there has to be some solution to this, to the dustbin. And then we found these dustbins, they're here, and they have a very good locking arrangement. So when you put the waste inside, you lock it. So if you lock it, it's closed, and no dog can open it. So we went to that extent of getting things that people would want. And that would help people. So there was no excuse that you can't segregate your waste and you can't keep it out at your front door. So that's how the segregation started in Panaji. We had a separate collection for medical waste. Medical waste from, we have it still, but we started it at that time. Medical waste from all the clinics, hospitals, because we didn't want this coming into the bins. Earlier, it was medical waste, everything that was dumped into the open bins. Today, all medical waste is collected from hospitals and clinics all around the city. Now, I will like to explain to you what happens to the waste that is put into the green bin. Green bin has wet waste. So this wet waste is collected and taken to composting stations that have been put up all over the city. As I told you earlier, we couldn't take it to the Kurka site anymore, that was closed. So where do we really take it in Panjim city? We had no place to take waste. So we decided to build these composting units everywhere. But we still had a problem with that, because at that time people said, not near my window, not here, not there. We managed to put up about 110 or 120 composting units. But unfortunately, many of them were broken, and this is at the instance of the elected representative. Because instead of solving the problem, it's a genuine problem. We had to compost the waste somewhere. You just can't dump it anywhere. So So if there was a problem in this composting unit, say maybe on certain days there was a little bit of smell, the worker who was supposed to do it didn't do it properly, it can happen. Or after treating the waste, somebody comes and puts fish waste inside, it would smell. There could be problems. So instead of trying to solve these problems, find out what is the problem, the local, the elected representative had to please voter. Because unfortunately today, we have become voters. We are not really citizens of the place. Many of us have just become voters to the elected representative. And if I do not help you, then I won't get my vote the next time. So they had to help these voters, and many of our composting units were demolished. Many of the composting units, the areas made way for gardens, because they felt that gardens were more important than garbage. But where does all this garbage go? And all the hotel waste, wet waste, all the wet waste from all the hotels that we collected would go in windrows. In the city itself, there's nowhere else we could take it to. This was the situation we were in, and we still are in. So we take it to windrows. And windrows is a very good concept, but it's difficult to have windrows within the city, because every week you've got to turn these windrows. And when you turn them, definitely you get some smell that comes out from it. And then you have residents all around. And then everybody will scream that the area is smelling, but what do you do? But this is what happens. So if you do not turn the waste, it does not compost. So we have to turn it, water it to keep down the smell. Use everything like cow dung, EM, whatever you can get. But there are problems. And these windrows would take about 30 to 45 days for the compost to be ready. It was a long time because more waste would come from the hotels. If you see, nowhere are we reducing waste. Waste is only increasing. We have to reduce our waste. In fact, this time we were very happy for the International Film Festival when Sanjit Rodrigues decided to put a stop to a lot of things that created waste at the film festival. For example, at the food court, he put a stop to your plates that were made of that silver foil. There's nothing doing. You get stainless steel plates, you wash them, or you get the leaf plates. But we are not going to allow you to get these plates that create a lot of problems. All the gardas in the city have been asked to use stainless steel plates. Take it and wash it and get it back. Or if people do not want to eat willfully and are not really, you know, are scared to eat it in a stainless steel plate, I think take your plate from home, eat the willfully and come back. But you will not get those plates that create problems. See, we've got to reduce the waste. We stopped paper cups. Paper cups is a big problem. And nobody is taking paper cups which have that, you know, because they're lined with, you know, it has a plastic lining on the outside. It looks like paper, but it doesn't go for recycling. So we have a huge problem with paper cups. So these also were stopped. And many other things. So that way we reduced the waste that came out from the film festival from 5 tons to 2 tons per day this year. Now since we have a problem with that windrow composting, we're still continuing with it. It's not that we can do away with it till we have a place somewhere to actually treat waste. We procure these organic waste converters. These are machines that work very well. Each machine can take 2.5 tons per machine in a 8-hour shift. So we have three of these machines, so we can treat 15 tons of waste. So we have two shifts, so we can treat about 15 to 20 tons of waste. And the waste is ground, and then it's fed with some inoculants and with sawdust. And it's difficult today to get sawdust. See, we have problems all along. As we go along, we find one problem or the other. It's very difficult to find sawdust today because we need it in large quantities. And the sawdust that is available in Goa today is about 40 rupees a bag. And in Karnataka, sawdust is 80 rupees a bag. So you have trucks from there coming to take our Goa sawdust. So we have a problem there. But we have to find a solution. We can't say that we are going to give up. So we segregate all our paper waste and we shred all that paper waste, and all that is added to this to replace, not replace totally, but a large quantity of sawdust. So we are you know, throughout we are trying to find solutions to the problems that we face. And the waste from this composting station takes about 10 days to compost, and then it's kept a while for another 5 days and it's ready. So as against 30 to 45 days, we can do something in 10 to 15 days. So this does solve a problem to a great extent. But our problems are not over, because while we can take about 15 to 20 tons of waste, we get 30 to 35 tons of wet waste in the city. So the rest we have to put in heaps and we have to compost that. So we still have a problem and there still is a little smell, but we are trying to find solutions, we will find solutions, and ultimately when we find the space that we are actually begging for, then we'll be able to do our waste management even better. Now I would like to tell you what happens to the waste from the black bin, which is the dry bin. Everybody would segregate their waste into wet and dry, but in the dry bin we would get all dry waste mixed up. We would get paper, which we ask them to do, paper, plastics, metal, shoes, cloth, magazines, slippers, thermocol, name it, that would be in the dry bin. Now when this was collected from households on every Mondays and Thursdays, we would get about 12 to 13 trucks of dry waste every day going to the, we called it a sorting center at that time, it sort of became a dump yard. So these 13 trucks would go there. And then we had private scrap workers, not workers working under the municipality, because we needed more workers. So we got these private scrap workers to come and help segregate the waste. It's a very difficult task when all the waste, dry waste, is mixed up. Much more difficult it would have been if wet waste was mixed up with that. But today we have dry waste separately, so we could do this. But what happened with these private recyclers? They would pick up only the best. They would pick up something that got them value, and then they would dump the rest. So our problems were not over, because all the rest would become dumps, and then would become heaps, and then we had heaps of dry waste. So we decided that, come on, let's go one step further and let's try to solve the problem. We have been improving all along, and I would say improving because I'm really confident and I know that we have been improving. We are not regressing, we are progressing. And what we decided is, let's get all the hotels to segregate their dry waste instead of getting it all together. So we have, now in, we couldn't tell all the hotels to put your 4 bins and all that, so we went into bags. So we have the pink bag for paper waste, the orange bag or brown bag for plastic waste, the black bag for metal and glass, and the white bag for non-recyclables. And this waste is collected every day from the hotels, as against the waste we used to collect from hotels on Mondays, on Tuesdays and Fridays. Now we collect it every day. Wet waste is collected every day, dry waste is collected every day from these hotels, all the hotels that are segregating waste. Similarly, we did the same in housing colonies. We have not started it all over Panjim because we thought, let's go stepwise. And it would be better to start in societies because these societies are gated. So you know what is happening within. So in these housing colonies, the municipality supplied these 4 bins. Now one bin is for paper, the other one for plastics, the third for metal and glass, and the fourth for non-recyclables. Now what happens in the housing colony? We don't want people to come down and put it in, because until people are fully aware and educated about the system, we do not want to mess up the system. So what we have is one person who collects the waste from every household. Each one segregates again into the same wet and dry. The dry bin is brought down. But we tell people, please make sure that your dry waste is dry. It's clean and dry. This is very important, because if you have dirty waste, stinking waste, or some masala in your bag, which we get, and I brought samples also to show you later if you want to see, then it's very difficult to segregate that, and it's neither wet nor dry, and all the rest of the dry waste gets contaminated with that one bit of dirty waste. So we make people segregate, clean their waste, and then send it down. And when it comes down, the person will separate it into these four bins. We've even put latches on the four bins with locks so that nobody on their way down brings the bag and just throws it into the bin. So we made sure that these are latches with locks. And there is a separate bin, if you go to the previous slide, which is kept there for medical waste. This is very important because household medical waste like diapers, baby diapers, adult diapers, sanitary napkins, these are things that should not go into the dry waste. When it comes like that, our workers have to put their hands in it, whether they have gloves or they don't have gloves. Sometimes they take it off when it is too hot. And we don't want them putting their hands into this dirty type of waste. And as per the rules, all this medical waste has to go into a yellow bag. So we insist that households put their waste in a yellow bag and then it is kept in the blue bin below. If it is not in the yellow bag, we don't pick it up. We leave it there because we don't want to touch it, and it has to be nice, safe, tied up and kept in the yellow bag. Now what happens to all this waste? The next step is we have our vehicle that comes to pick up. It's a separate vehicle for housing colonies to pick up their segregated waste. The vehicle has bags in it and all the waste is emptied separately. So you have paper separate, plastic separate, metal glass separate and non-recyclable separate. So this is how it goes in housing colonies. In places which are not gated, this is what we do. We started it in Kampal and we want to start it in places like Miramar, Altino, where you know you don't have a society, it's an open colony. And this is where we send the person around with a cycle. Each house will keep their waste in four parts. This person, the municipal worker, will come every day and empty the waste and take it away. So you have no excuse to go and dump your waste on the road. People are coming, the municipality is coming to your house every day to pick up the waste. So what need is there for you to go and dump this waste on the road? And anyone who does this just doesn't have civic sense. It happens with wet waste. Though we pick it up every day, people do not want to keep their fish at home when they bring it at night. And there are solutions for this. Many people put that waste in a little container, keep it in the fridge, deep freeze. Next day, when the wet waste is collected, empty it and it goes. So there are solutions. If you want to find a way, you can find a way. If you don't want to do it, you'll dump it on the street. When this waste comes to our sorting center, and I would like to invite y'all one day to come and have a look at our sorting center. It may not be a classy sorting center like you have abroad. We do not have conveyor belts. We will have those ultimately because we keep improving. But we are trying to use whatever we have. So we have made this sort of a jali. It's a net where all the waste comes onto it. And there again it is sorted out. Because if we have plastics, we have different types of plastics. So we separate that into the different kinds of plastics. Then the metal and glass of course go directly to their sections. Then you have paper which goes there. Some people mix here and there, so we have to sort it out. Now when we get, and then you have the non-recyclables, and I would like to talk more on the non-recyclables because that's the problem material. And once you do this, once all this material is sorted out, it is kept in separate fractions. Now all the recyclables like plastics are recyclable. Certain type of paper is recyclable. Like I told you, the cup that you get at Inox and at Coffee Day and all those cups are not recyclable. They're non-recyclable. They're a problem. So we have to get them to change that. So all the recyclables, paper, plastic, tetra pack that they're taking, is baled by us in this big baling machine. And then you have the bales that come out. These are the bales, and the bales are sold. These go for recycling. So this is what happens to all our recyclables. Now what happens to our non-recyclables? Normally what would happen, this would have to be dumped in a landfill. This is happening all over the world. Wherever they have landfills, they have large landfills, we don't have any landfills. So we have a problem with it, we cannot dump it anywhere. So what do we do with it? The government has formed a monitoring committee about a year back, which continues. Now we worked, we are a part of the monitoring committee, like I told you earlier, and we felt that there has to be a solution to this problem. So during our talks and in that discussion, the Pollution Control Board would actually, you know, monitor this whole thing, and through which department the monitoring committee is functioning. Got these cement companies, which are in Karnataka, to take our non-recyclables. Now these non-recyclables are used in their furnaces in place of coal. So they need all this material so that they can reduce their coal content and burn this. So we were happy that at least it's going somewhere and it doesn't have to be dumped in a landfill. But for this, the cement company says that you have got to bale it in bales of 30 centimeters by 30 centimeters. We had the big baling machines that wouldn't do. We couldn't send it in bags because the cost of transport would be too high. So the government supplied us the baling machines. It took time, but we finally got the baling machines. And all these items, which are non-recyclable, are baled into bales of 30 by 30. Here we have them. You have all the material that is mixed that cannot be recycled. You have all your multi-layered packets, which are a big problem. Your Uncle Chips and Kurkure and whatever you have, that is baled separately. Then we have cloth, lot of cloth that is thrown away. We get lots, heaps of cloth every day, because clothes are cheaply available today, so you wear and then, you know, discard them easily. And then you have a lot of shoes, like I showed you, so we bale the shoes also. So all these materials are afterwards sent to the ACC factory in Karnataka. Now that doesn't mean our problems have ended. We are left with, but we are left with very, very little waste. Now out of a truckload of waste, this is the residual waste that we get. So we are working so much to finally end up at zero waste. I would call it zero because there's no more we can do with this waste. So out of a truckload, we get a sort of a drum full of waste that is left over. So this is what we want to do and continue with, so that in the end, this is all we have left. So we don't need a landfill, but you know, it's not the landfill that will take all our non-recyclables. But like I said, this is not the end of it. You know, the cost of transporting this material to Karnataka is borne by the government. Now the producers, they make they produce the item, they sell it, fancy packaging, and government has to pay the cost. We have to pay the cost. We of course eat all whatever is there, but that's the problem. It costs 20,000 rupees per truck to send this waste to Karnataka. Each truck can hold 10 tons, but because of the volume, we can put in only 3.5 tons to 4 tons, which means we are spending 5,000 per ton to send this waste out. It is a lot of money. I'm telling you this is because we have to reduce that non-recyclable waste that we are just wasting. We're throwing it away. And at the CCP, we're trying to reduce that type of waste because we want to bring this cost down. And we've even thought that we have to follow up with the government, and the government, the monitoring committee is working on it. We have to get in the polluter. There is a polluter pays principle. So we have to get that. And as for the plastic recycle rules, you have an extended producer's responsibility. They have to pay towards cost of collecting that type of material that cannot be recycled and sending it for recycling. At least we have to recover some amount of it. So I have compiled a list of all these manufacturers from the packets with their website. Everything is there on the packet, and it has gone to the Pollution Control Board, and now they are getting in touch with the companies, because I think they have to pay some cost towards transporting this material. They just can't produce their materials, their packaging, and get away with it. Earlier, we had worked with the PET bottle companies. If you remember, maybe about 10 years earlier, 8 years earlier, these PET bottles were strewn about everywhere. You won't see much of that happening now, because we had meetings through the government again with all the PET companies. I mean, whether it's Coke, Pepsi, Bisleri, they were all called for meetings. And we sat with these companies. That time I belonged to an NGO. I still belong to one. People's movement, and that's how we worked very hard with the government to get all these companies to sit across the table and discuss and let us know how they're going to take their bottles back. Otherwise, in fact, Poor Foundation the year earlier had collected all these PET bottles, took it in a vehicle and threw it into the bicycle factory's compound. Today they would have welcomed it, but at that time they didn't know what to do with it. So these companies decided, yes, we have to do something because that polluter pays principle is there. We have to do something. And the companies got together. They said we'll put up 5 collection centers in Goa. They did put up 1 collection center at the Belgian roundabout. One was in Kalangut, one in Margao, and one in Mapsa, and Kolva, I think. So these collection centers, what were there? Pepsi was manning this. The transportation from here, the government gave them a shed at Dwaris. Coke was managing that. They would shred the bottles. Transportation was paid by another company. This was shredded and then sent down south for recycling, out of which the recycled material would be used, baled and sent, and recycled material would be used to make teddy bears and t-shirts as fillers. So when a use was found and when there was value added to that bottle, now there was no need for Coke or Pepsi or anyone to take it back, because all the rag pickers just collect bottles because it fetches them a high price. The minute you add some value to that waste, that is when it is picked up. So this is exactly what happened to the PET bottles. And we want to do the same thing to the multi-layered packets and other items that cannot be recycled. Again, you had Tetra Pak. This also was a problem. This was dumped everywhere. And we worked, the municipality worked with the Tetra Pak company. And the Tetra Pak said, you better take your Tetra Pak back. It's causing us a lot of problems. So the Tetra Pak company said, yes, we'll supply you a bathing machine, bale the Tetra Pak, send it to us, we'll pay the cost of transport. And out of this Tetra Pak today, they make roofing sheets, they make books, they make pencils, lots of things that are made out of Tetra Pak. So this is how different items that could not be recycled earlier have been recycled today. We still have a problem with thermocon. You know, everything comes packaged in thermocon. It's a very good thing for packaging because the fridge doesn't come damaged, computers come well packed, the modem will be so small, packing will be so big. All that packing ends up at our sorting center at Santanese. And we've got heaps and heaps and heaps of it. We have a problem today because we don't have a styropacker. We're trying to get one ultimately. We could have sent this to ACC, but the problem is we can't bail it. The minute we bail it, it bounces back. We just can't bail it. So we have a problem with this. And I would request everybody now, it is the Christmas season. If you all are making anything out of thermocol, please don't buy more. Please come to our sorting center. We've got lots of it. Take it. Any school programs, I know it will come back to us, but at least it will be reused until we find, we get our styropacker and we are able to send it for recycling once we have reduced the volume. E-waste, you know now, as countries abroad also have a lot of e-waste, we also have a lot of e-waste now, but fortunately there is a group in Saligaon, I don't know if anyone's come here, that's Atero, who are taking the sea waste to a unit that has been set up in Delhi. So they have got collection points where everybody should keep their e-waste. Of course, you are not paid for it, but at least the e-waste goes somewhere and it is not dumped. Because it is very dangerous if this e-waste is taken by our recyclers, because they just break it up and there could be material inside that is very harmful. Similarly, we have items like our bulbs and our tube lights. This is also part of e-waste. But if we have to send this right now for recycling, it costs us 100 rupees to recycle one tube light. I don't think the CCP can afford it. If we broke, we already are, and we'll be even more broke. Because it is 100 rupees to recycle one tube light. A tube light that costs us 30 or 40 rupees. So right now what we are doing is, we have to send it to the same people at Delhi or Karnataka, but cost of transport, cost of packing, cost of recycling comes to 100 rupees. So right now we are just collecting it all together until we find some other alternative. And we are also collecting batteries. And the municipality is going to put up collection boxes all over the city for you to drop your batteries into the boxes so that we can collect them at one point. And then when our batteries are full, probably we'll tie up with the industrial units and send it along with industrial waste through the industrial disposal site. You know, we actually, in the new plan that we have a plan for the city. That's when we get space. And we also want to have an art center. And we want to open this art center at the sorting center. Because you get a lot of waste at these places and a lot of items that can be made out of it. Because we want that thing, the concept of reuse, recycle, to be there in everybody's mind. And there are beautiful things. In fact, this was made at Sunnapuram. I attended one of the courses. Beautiful things that you can make out of wasted water. Then you can make out of paper and napkin ring. That is also out of wasted water. And then you crochet your plastic bags. And if anyone wants to learn how to do it, you have Valerie. She made this bag and she makes a lot of things out of this. So once we have this art center, we can invite people from colleges, from all around to come and try their hands at this art. Like I told you earlier, if waste is mixed, if waste is dumped, there's nothing we can do about it. It's not fair for us to leave this for the workers to segregate. I think we need to think about the workers. In fact, that is why I spend a lot of my time along with the workers, for them to feel that, you know, we are not neglected, that the others are part of us. In fact, the other day I asked a group of people, I don't know if anyone is here, they have a group called the Anchor of Hope. And I told them, you all go and you all have, you all give food to old aged homes and you all give food to children's homes and maybe snacks and all. But nobody ever thinks of our garbage workers. They work, they slog from morning to evening. They're doing this work. Hardly anybody comes to see them, to see what they're doing. It's our waste that they're handling, but we just leave them to do that. So this group came along, they brought, you know, some snacks and some tea, and then they told them, they said, you know, we appreciate what you're doing for us. And our garbage workers literally cried. Because I think this was the first time that some